ವಲ್ಲಭ ಗಿರಿವರಧಾರಿ ಯಶೋದಾನಂದನ ವ್ರಜ ಜನರಂಜನ ಯಶೋದಾನಂದನ ವ್ರಜ ಜನರಂಜನ ಯಶೋದಾನಂದನ ವ್ರಜ ಜನರಂಜನ ಯಶೋದಾನಂದನ ವ್ರಜ ಜನರಂಜನ ಯಮುನಾ ತೀರ ವನಚಾರಿ ಯಮುನಾ ತೀರ ವನಚಾರಿ ಜಯ ರಾಧ ಮಾಧವ ಕುಂಜ ಬಿಹಾರಿ ಜಯ ರಾಧ ಮಾಧವ ಕುಂಜ ಬಿಹಾರಿ ಜಯ ಗೋಪಿಜನ ವಲ್ಲಭ ಗಿರಿವರಧಾರಿ ಜಯ ಗೋಪಿಜನ ವಲ್ಲಭ ಗಿರಿವರಧಾರಿ ಯಶೋದಾನಂದನ ವ್ರಜ ಜನರಂಜನ ಯಶೋದಾನಂದನ ವ್ರಜ ಜನರಂಜನ ಯಮುನಾ ತೀರ ವನಚಾರಿ ಯಮುನಾ ತೀರ ವನಚಾರಿ ಜಯ ರಾಧ ಮಾಧವ ಕುಂಜ ಬಿಹಾರಿ ಜಯ ಗೋಪಿಜನ ವಲ್ಲಭ ಗಿರಿವರಧಾರಿ ಯಶೋದಾನಂದನ ವ್ರಜ ಜನರಂಜನ ಯಮುನಾ ತೀರ ವನಚಾರಿ ಜಯ ರಾಧ ಮಾಧವ ಕುಂಜ ಬಿಹಾರಿ ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಪ್ರಭು ನಿತ್ಯಾನಂದ ಶ್ರೀ ಅದ್ವೈತ ಗದಾಧ ಶ್ರೀವಾಸಾದಿ ಭಕ್ತವೃಂದ ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಪ್ರಭು ನಿತ್ಯಾನಂದ ಶ್ರೀ ಅದ್ವೈತ ಗದಾಧರ ಶ್ರೀವಾಸಾದಿ ಭಕ್ತವೃಂದ ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಪ್ರಭು ನಿತ್ಯಾನಂದ ಶ್ರೀ ಅದ್ವೈತ ಗದಾಧರ ಶ್ರೀವಾಸಾದಿ ಭಕ್ತವೃಂದ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರಿ ಹರಿ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರಿ ಹರಿ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರಿ ಹರಿ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರಿ ಹರಿ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರಿ ಹರಿ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರಿ ಹರಿ ಗೌರನಿತಾಯ್ 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 ಜಯ ಗೌರನಿತಾಯ್ ಜಯ ಗೌರನಿತಾಯ್ 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 ಜಯ ಗೌರನಿತಾಯ್ ಪ್ರಭುಪದ 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 ಶ್ರೀಲ ಪ್ರಭುಪದ ಜಯ ಗುರುದೇವ 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 ಜಯ ಗುರುದೇವ ಹರಿ ಬೋಲ್ ಹರಿ ಬೋಲ್ ಹರಿ ಬೋಲ್ ನಿತ್ಯ ಗೌರ ಹರಿ ಬೋಲ್ ಜಯ ಓಂ ವಿಷ್ಣುಪಾದ ಪರಮಹಂಸ ಪರಿವ್ರಾಜಿಕಾಚಾರ್ಯ ಸ್ತೋತ್ರ ಸತ
श्री श्री माधवय चरण अरविंद भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी महाराज श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। इस्कॉन फाउंडर आचार्य श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय। नामाचार्य श्रील हरिदास ठाकुर की जय। प्रेम से कहो श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद की जय। श्री श्री राधा कृष्ण गोप गोपीनाथ श्याम कुंद राधा कुंद गिरी गोवर्धन की जय। श्री वृंदावन धाम की जय। श्री मायापुर धाम की जय। श्री नवदीप धाम की जय। श्री जगन्नाथपुरी धाम की जय। श्री श्री राधा लंडनेश्वरा होली धाम की जय। श्री गंगा माई श्री यमुना माई की जय। श्री भक्ति देवी श्री तुलसी देवी की जय। श्री हरि नाम संकीर्तन की जय। श्री बृहत् मृदंगा की जय। श्री श्रील प्रभुपाद ट्रांसेंडेंटल बुक डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन की जय। श्री सामवेद भक्त वृंद की जय। जय निताय गौर प्रेमानंदे। ऑल ग्लोरीज टू द असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज। All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the lotus feet of Sri Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga and Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna. So I beg for the blessings of all the assembled Vaishnavas because I feel unqualified to speak of any topics, what to speak of the 10th canto. So I beg you to please bless me so that I can please you, Guru Maharaj, Guru Parampara, and Radha Krishna, Radha Landanishwara. Thank you. So we are reading today from Canto 10, Chapter 21, Texts 13 and 14. 14 is on the board, and I'll read 13. Yeah. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So, text 13. Gavascha Krishna Mukha Nirgata Venu Gita. I'll say the 13, then 14 we'll say together. Piyusham uttabhita karna putai pibantya shava shrutastana payaka valasmatashtur govindamatmani drashru kala sprashantya. Translation. Using their upraised ears as vessels, the cows are drinking the nectar of the flute song flowing out of Krishna's mouth. The cows, their mouths full of milk from their mother's moist nipples, stand still as they take Govinda within themselves through their tear-filled eyes and embrace him within their hearts. And now the 14 we'll say it together. Prayo batamba vihaga munayo vanesmin.
Prayo batamba vihaga munayo vanesmin.
Krishneksitam taduditam kalavenu gitam.
Krishneksitam taduditam kalavenu gitam.
Aruya yedruma bhujan ruchira pravalan. Shranvanti milita drisho vigatanya vacha.
Shranvanti milita drisho vigatanya vacha.
Prayo batamba vilagamunayo vanesmin.
Prayo batamba vilagamunayo vanesmin.
Krishne kshitam taduditam kalavenu gitam.
Krishne kshitam taduditam.
आरु ये द्रुम भुजन रुचिर प्रवालं श्रण्वन्ति मिलित दृशो विगतान्यवाच प्रायो बताम्ब विहगा मुनयो वनेस्मिन् कृष्णेशितं तदुदितं कलवा वेणुगीतम् आरुह्य ये द्रुम भुजन रुचिर प्रवालं श्रण्वन्ति मिलित दृशो विगतान्यवाच
कृष्णेशितं तदुदितं कलवेणुगीतम्
आरुह्य ये द्रुम भुजं रुचिर प्रवालं शृण्वन्ति मिलित दृशो विगतान्यवाच
प्रायो बताम्ब विगहा मुनयो वनेस्मिन् कृष्णेक्षितं तदुदितं कलवेणुगीतम्
आरुह्य ये द्रुमा भुजं रुचिर प्रवालं
आरुह्य ये द्रुमा भुजं रुचिर प्रवालं
शृण्वन्ति मिलित दृशो विगतान्यवाच
शृण्वन्ति मिलित दृशो प्रायो बताम्ब विहगा मुनयो वनेस्मिन् कृष्णेक्षितं तदुदितं कलवेणुगीतम् आरुह्य ये द्रुम भुजं रुचिर प्रवालं शृण्वन्ति मिलित दृशो विगतान्यवाच प्रायो बताम्ब विहगा मुनयो वनेस्मिन् कृष्णेक्षितं तदुदितं कलवेणुगीतम् आरुह्य ये द्रुम भुजं रुचिर प्रवालं शृण्वन्ति मिलित दृशो विगतान्यवाच
लेडीज
प्रायो बताम्ब विगहा मुनयो वनेस्मिन् कृष्णेक्षितं तदुदितं कलवेणुगीतम् आरुह्य ये द्रुम भुजं रुचिर प्रवालं शृण्वन्ति मिलित दृशो विगतान्यवाच प्रायो बताम्ब विगता मुनयो वनेस्मिन् कृष्णेक्षितं तदुदितं कलवेणुगीतम् आरुह्य ये द्रुम भुजं रुचिर प्रवालं Shrinivanti Milata Vidusho Vigatanya Vacha.
Word for word translation. Praya, almost. Bata, certainly. Amba, O mother. Vihaga, the birds. Munaya, great sages. Vane, in the forest. Asmin, this. Krishna Kshitam, in order to see Krishna. Tat Uditam, created by him. Kalavenu Gitam, sweet vibrations made by playing the flute. Aruya, rising. Ye, who? Druma Bhujan, to the branches of the trees. Ruchira Pravalan, having beautiful creepers and twigs. Shranvanti, they hear. Milita Drishaha, closing their eyes. Vigata Anyavacha, stopping all other sounds. Translation by Srila Prabhupada's disciples. Thank you. So, O Mother, in this forest all the birds have risen onto the beautiful branches of the trees to see Krishna. With closed eyes, they are simply listening in silence to the sweet vibrations of his flute, and they are not attracted by any other sound. Surely these birds are on the same level as great sages. Purport. The birds resemble sages because they live in the forest, keep their eyes closed, observe silence, and remain motionless. Significantly, it is stated here that even great sages become maddened by the sound of Krishna's flute, which is completely spiritual vibration. The word Ruchira Pravalan indicates that even the branches of the trees are transformed in ecstasy when struck by the vibrations of Krishna's flute song. Indra, Brahma, Shiva and Vishnu, being primordial gods, travel throughout the universe and have extensive knowledge of the science of music. And yet, even these great personalities have never heard or composed music like that which emanates from Krishna's flute. Indeed, the birds are so moved by the blissful sound that in their ecstasy, they close their eyes and cling to the branches to avoid falling off the trees. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur explains that the gopis would sometimes address each other as Amba, mother. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vancha Kalpataribhascha Kripa Sindhubhyayavacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advait Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Jai Shri Shri Jagannath Ji Baldev Ji Subhadra Maharani Ki Jai Shri Shri Radha Landanishwara Ki Jai Shri Giriraj Govardhan Ji Ki Jai Shri Shri Gaur Nitai Ki Jai, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. So, thank you all. So this particular chapter is also known as Venu Geet, because the title of the chapter is the Gopis glorify Krishna's flute. Venu, as you all know, is Krishna's flute. And Geet is song. So Venu Geet, like that. And of course, there's a song called Madhurashtakam, which probably all of you have heard. Bhakti Charu Swami Maharaj sings a lot. So that describes Krishna's sweetness. Everything about Krishna is sweet. All his details are sweet. I'll just sing the first verse and the meaning. Adharam madhuram, vadanam madhuram, nayanam madhuram, hasitam madhuram, ridayam madhuram, gamanam madhuram, madhuradipate akhilam madhuram. So the meaning is that his lips are sweet. His cherubic face is sweet. Cherubic means, you know, rosy, innocent, childlike, chubby face is sweet. This is Krishna, of course. His mesmerizing eyes are sweet. His soulful laugh and smile is sweet. His loving heart is sweet. His enchanting gait walk is sweet. Everything about the king of sweetness is sweet. So Madhuradipate is king of sweetness, is the king of sweetness. We can see Radha London Ishwara completely embodied. they are sweet like anything, like that. So Krishna is like that. So on one verse it also starts with Venur Madhuro. His flute is sweet, like that. So Krishna embodies this sweetness, and this particular chapter basically concerns how Krishna enters the forest of Vrindavan in the autumn season, Sharat Rutu. He enters there, and when he is herding the cows, he starts playing the flute, and how, because of the sweetness, all the gopis who have yet not had personal relationship with Krishna, they are lamenting that how the non-moving beings and supposedly being who can't speak and all that, they are, you know, engaged in intimate relationship with Krishna so very sweetly, nicely. And we are so unfortunate that we haven't had the opportunity to associate with him personally. So Krishna enters the forest and he starts playing the flute. And the sound is so beautiful, so mellifluous. Mellifluous means sounding like honey, as sweet as honey. You know, the original honey, which is really produced by the bees, unmixed by anything, is quite sweet. So it's like that. And it brings on love in the gopis for Krishna. And they embrace each other and they discuss. Oh, you know, because they haven't had personal intimate relationship with Krishna, they have brothers who are gopas. They have mothers who have had, who have seen Krishna. So they discuss with each other. Oh, my brother was saying and that, they all entered into the mouth of this big serpent, you know, and they thought it was something non-moving. So they entered it and then they were caught there, you know. They didn't know what to do. They didn't know where to go. And the serpent was closing its mouth. And they suddenly Krishna, you know, he expanded. And then he tore the, serpent. And then he freed everyone. So they are all exchanging this. Kathayantascha mam nityam tushyanti cha ramanti cha. So this is the gopis. Prabhupada said that our movement represents how we have to follow the gopis in their mood. And this is the mood. The gopis are always exchanging notes about Krishna, talking about Krishna, like that. So the gopis then say, oh, how, you know, dear is the flute. This is transcendental envy. How transcendental envy comes into being. That flute, you know, it is so lucky that Krishna holds it in his mouth so it can drink from the lotus lips of Krishna. You know, how fortunate it is. So, but we are not so fortunate because we are not getting that opportunity like that. And we'll see how, you know, this feeling of theirs is then reciprocated by Krishna later on. And then the bamboo trees on the banks of the river, you know, they, from which the flute is made, they are oozing sap, which the acharyas consider is like shedding tears, you know, tears of joy that, oh, our child, because the flute is made from bamboo stick, our child has such an intimate opportunity to serve Krishna. It's directly in the mouth. But look at us. We are stuck here on the shores of this river. And who knows when Krishna will come towards us. Yeah? So they are happy for their child and happy that they're serving the Lord through Krishna. But also at the same time, they're feeling that the separation from Krishna's service, like that. And then the peacocks, you know, the peacocks, they get mad when they hear Krishna's flute. So they all start dancing madly, matta, it is written. Not just dancing, but dancing madly in a circle, yeah, keeping Krishna in the center. Krishna is in the center, they are dancing madly around him. And then that makes Krishna dance as well. It is written, he enters the forest as the greatest of dancers. So he, while he wants to dance, he also invokes that in other living beings. So the peacocks begin to dance, and that dance is so enchanting that it says that the deers and the birds, who are usually shy of going near living entities, they go to the mountain tops, mountain cliffs. And from there, where they can get a nice bird's eye view of what's happening, they see that visual. And when they hear the flute, they are stunned, totally stunned by it. And then this verse, that the birds, all the birds, have risen onto the beautiful branches of trees to see Krishna. So some of them have also, you know, going to the mountaintops, they are also on treetops. They are there. And with closed eyes, they simply listen in silence to the sweet vibrations of his flute. And they are compared to sages here, like that. So, you know, Krishna, when he speaks about samadhi, which is what these birds are seemingly doing, they just, you know, listening with rapt attention, they want to cut out all sounds. Usually we close our eyes when we not only want to shut out sounds and everything from outside, but also from inside, because the mind is always chattering. So you know, shut up, you know, I want to hear the holy name, this thing. So we want to shut out those sounds. So they are in samadhi. And Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita that yam labdhuva chaparam labham manyate na adhikam tata. That, you know, the yogi is situated in such transcendental, he's situated in this truth. Yeah, he knows that happiness which can't be gained anywhere else in that situation. Yeah, yasmin sthitona dukhena gurun api vichalyate. That situated thus, you know, he is so powerful in that nothing shakes him. Even the greatest material miseries of the three worlds can't shake him up like that. So the birds are signifying that. They are, you know, they are in samadhi and they long for nothing else than that vibration of Krishna's flute. Yeah, and they want to shut out all other sounds so that they have gained this beautiful transcendental ecstasy. They don't want to lose it. And then, seeing the peacocks and all, All other living entities, they are also stunned. They don't know what to do. But they are playing their roles. Like the clouds, you know. They see, oh, there's a lot of sun. So let me cover my dear Krishna. You know, so they cover the sun and therefore they bring shade to Krishna. So it's their service. The rivers and all, you know, when they hear Krishna's flute of Krishna's, sound of Krishna's flute, they get agitated. And what do? They go and embrace Krishna's lotus feet with their waters and embrace them within the heart. So it brings out this loving propensity of everyone. And only the Lord can do it. So therefore we can see in Vrindavan, everyone is mesmerized. The gopis further, you know, see that, oh, these deers, they have come. But you see the male deer and the female deers have come. And they are all listening to the Lord's flute with rapt attention. And even the male deer is not envious when the female deer goes close to Krishna. In fact, they encourage the female deers to go in front of Krishna. How fortunate are these deers, you know? And how fortunate that they have husbands who allow their wives to go freely close to Krishna. Our husbands are envious of Krishna, inimical. And so they don't want to serve Govinda. How unfortunate we are. Therefore, we also don't get the opportunity to serve Govinda. Even the deer's families have come, their children, and they are also close to Krishna. We wish our families also would have been there to partake of this nectar. But, you know, alas, we are unfortunate that we can't do it. And then they see, you know, at that time, the demigods in heaven who are all flying in their planes, you know, they are also looking at Krishna. And they are also taking in that sweet nectar. And they are along with the demigoddesses. And the demigoddesses, you know, their hair falls loose. And their garments also go loose. So it is a sign that they are also being attacked by Cupid's arrows, like that. And the gopis discuss this, that the gopis knew which of the demigods, you know, which of these demigods are who, and they knew their names and all, and what is going on. And they say, oh my God, you know, even the demigods, they like their wives to be appreciative of Krishna. They like their wives to take part in it. Yeah? And their wives are taking part in it. But alas, we are unfortunate. Because of our husbands, our children and us, we can't take part in it. So the gopis have this mood. It's transcendental envy because they don't want to take what what these birds, deer have. But they're saying, I should also have it. If I have it, that will be my greatest fortune. So they are making a choice, and that choice is the highest, because that is what is the highest. Anything connected to Krishna favorably for serving him becomes auspicious, all auspicious, like that. So therefore, they are trying to connect that, oh, we want that association and make our lives auspicious, like that. And then the peacocks, after having danced, the senior most peacocks, they want to reward Krishna because they asked Krishna, you play the flute and let us sing and dance. And Krishna, you know, he listens to his devotees. He knows they are devotees. So he reciprocates with them. So they want to reward Krishna. And therefore, they take out the best of plumes, their feathers, and they give it to Krishna, offer it to Krishna. And Krishna immediately takes it and puts it on his turban. So the acharyas say that, see, even how this reciprocation of Guru Dakshina and, you know, of whatever rasas they are exchanging, they also have reciprocation there. And what is a peacock feather? It is actually thought to be muchi,
unclean, not to be touched like that. But anything that comes in connection with Krishna becomes pure. We pray when we have to purify, you know, Om apavitrova, apavitra pavitrova, sarva avastha gatopiva. Yeah? Yat smaret prundarikaksham. That whether it is unclean or clean, and in whatever condition it is, yeah, or in all walks of life, if it is persons, in any walk of life, if they are unclean or clean, if they think about yat smaret prundarikaksham, if they think about Krishna, then automatically they become pure. So there are processes of everything, like, you know, the conch shell, if it becomes impure, yeah, if it falls down or something becomes impure, and then it is washed, and then it is buried in the ground, in the earth for 7 days, and then it is considered pure, like that. And a conch shell basically is the bones, made from the bones of a cow. But it is considered auspicious because in the scriptures it is said that you can use it in the service of Krishna. So it becomes auspicious. Similarly, the peacock's feather also becomes auspicious when Krishna wears it. And Krishna takes it and wears it very proudly, you know, that this is given by my devotee. So whatever the devotee wants to give, when it is given with bhaktya upahartam, Krishna says, it doesn't matter patram, pushpam, phalam, toyam, very small, insignificant things for anyone. But tadham asnami bhaktya upahartam, if it is given by love. So here the, you know, the peacocks are making these presentations like that. So the whole of Vrindavan mood, you know, is to connect to the sound vibrations, spiritual sound vibrations, and be stunned by that, be in that, because that is everything. Yeah, the spiritual sound vibration is the highest. Like the birds, I mean, they're seeing Krishna, yet they're closing their eyes and listening to the sound vibration. How difficult it would be when Krishna is in front of you to close your eyes, because he's thought to be the sweetest and most beautiful. Very difficult. But they're still going for the sound vibration. So we can see how the sound vibration, it is said, I mean, I forget that, O Lord, you are in the deity form and in the sound form. But service to the sound form is even more important than service to the deity form. Because if one if one commits offenses to the deity form, then through service to the sound form, you can, you know, what do you call it, mitigate those offenses, like that. Rectify them, yeah, like that. So therefore, you know, that is also proved. So in the mood of the gopis, yes, and that is exchanging these pastimes of Krishna, which are so special. And this whole chapter is about the flute, which is very dear to Krishna. It is so dear that some of the queens of Krishna, they get envious of this. They ask the flute, why are you, how can Krishna spend so much time with you? He doesn't spend, you know. And they answer, the flute answers, you know, what can I do? I'm just made from bamboo. I'm a stick of bamboo, you know, curved, and then with 6 holes. But Krishna uses me, and then, you know, he loves me. What can I do? I have no qualifications, but Krishna, it's Krishna who, you know, imbues me with that nectar, which everyone loves, and he wants me close to him. So that's my good fortune, but I myself have no qualifications like that. So this is the mood of Vrindavan. Yeah. So I'll stop there. If anyone wants to share their comments, realizations, questions. Yes. What kind of rasa is it to be a bumblebee?
Bamboo fruit.
Oh, bamboo tree. What kind of rasa is it? Well, I mean, ordinarily it would be shantaras, but in Vrindavan that's different, because you can see even the branches of the trees, you know. That is another thing. Thank you for bringing that up. You know, Krishna, when he plays the flute, actually it is so nourishing to the souls that it is mentioned that even the branches of the trees get life, and they are also eager to hear Krishna's flute. So the rasa in Vrindavan is totally different. An ordinary bamboo tree, you know, it is in the mode of ignorance. Yeah, because trees are in the mode of ignorance, exposed to heat and light, because, you know, probably spend human life being naked or exposing themselves. So you get the birth of a species, you get birth in the species of trees like that. So ordinary trees. But those in Vrindavan are special. Yeah, because they can reciprocate, you know, their spirit inside all these living beings. And Krishna's flute and the nectar is so powerful, it nourishes the soul, and even the non-moving beings become moving and reciprocate as if they are living, you know, living beings. They are living beings, but, you know, they have, other attributes come up, moving, you know, from being a non-moving tree to moving, the branches, they attain that attribute after hearing Krishna's flute, like that. So reciprocation, I mean, it could be in any of the rasas, I don't know. I'm not an expert in that. But we can see that it is one of the higher rasas. And if they are so lucky that Krishna is personally present in front of them, and then he gives them that spiritual quality to see him, to hear his flute, and have that exchange, that means they are in some very, very high ras. Extremely fortunate. But I can't pinpoint which one. Yeah. Any other comments, questions, realizations?
So that means in one sense we are Krishna, in one sense, because we're simultaneously one with Krishna, but we're different. But we get very upset if we talk about the oneness. We're really into the difference, but we don't talk much about the oneness. It's like, oh, that's tough, but that's 50% of our philosophy that we're just writing off there when we get completely absorbed in the difference.
Mm. Mm. Yes.
Why are we so afraid of the fact that we are a part of Krishna?
Mm.
We're not really separate from Krishna ever.
Mm.
It's just a dream that we're separate.
Yeah. That is because we are one with Krishna in quality. Qualitatively, we are one with Krishna. That means we are part of him. He is the super soul. And the living entity is a 1/10,000 part of the tip of the hair. That size of the soul, you know, is part of Krishna. And then that soul takes on a body. Yeah. And that soul starts thinking, I am a body, because of, you know, exposure to the material nature and interactions with the material nature. And therefore we completely forget about the spiritual quality. But having spent lifetimes, having forgotten that, and living on this other 50% which you are talking about, you know, that I am this body for millions of lifetimes, we come to identify with that. So it is easy, you know, from there, this process is all about reviving that, oh, I am actually part of Krishna. Yeah. So we have forgotten that, and the process is to revive that I am part of Krishna. So we emphasize more that I am simultaneous one, but different from Krishna. The difference is also in Vibhu and Anu. You see, the spirit soul is at the individual living being is at the mercy of so many things. Material nature, Maya, time, yeah, the modes of material nature. All these, they shackle the living entity into forgetfulness of his or her original position. Yeah? And when we come to Krishna consciousness, it is easy to think, oh, I'm part of... Of course, we should think that all the time, that I am consciousness, who has taken on a body. That is true. But the difference is also emphasized so that we don't become sahajiyas and take it for granted that, yes, you know, the difference is not there. I am on the same level as Krishna. I am not, and I can never be. Because I will always be small. Krishna will always be great. That difference will always be there. Even when I realize my position and go back to the spiritual world. Even if I go to Krishna Golok Vrindavan. So therefore it is better to be in that mood all the time. So that, you know, we are not fooled by the modes into thinking that, oh, qualitatively I'm one with Krishna. So, you know, I'm as good, great as Krishna. You know, the Mayavadis also, that is one of their problems. They emphasize the equality, but they emphasize it 100%. The difference is not there. They call each other Narayan.
Yeah, they have the opposite.
They have the opposite problems. But we emphasize it so that we always remember, I am small. I can never be equal to Krishna. No one can be equal to Krishna. So and secondly, humility, that is the greatest quality that attracts Krishna. Nothing, at the time of death, whatever our achievements, if the state of our consciousness is still contaminated, there's no going back. So this humility is that quality of the consciousness that, you know, purifies it. And to be humble, we have to know this, that I can never be equal to Krishna. I will always be the servant. What to speak of servant? There's a huge guru. We come in the guru parampara. So there's a huge line already. You know, I am trillionth or something in the line, you know, in serving Krishna. There are so many gurus, their disciples, there's so many Vaishnavas before me. And even around me, you know. So that will always be there. So, and that is good. Because that helps us to take this mood that the gopis are taking. That I need this. I need this spiritual sound vibration. I need the association. And then I'll be able to at least remember always that I am consciousness, part and parcel of Krishna, qualitatively one with him. But at the same time, I know that, you know, I have to realize my true position. What to speak of Krishna, even amongst Vaishnavas, I'm way, 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 way. And that's a good position to be, because you get guidance. And then you can give guidance to others as well, because it's a chain. And everyone gets nourished. Is that, does that?
Yeah, very, very nice answer, thank you. I had another question. Is it possible to always think of Krishna, in the sense of always think of the holy name of Krishna, at least to that extent, and yet still be envious of Krishna? Is it possible, because this is really our root problem, isn't it? We're, we're not really even in the material world, but we're somehow being put here like a prisoner. We're trapped here because we've got some envy of Krishna. We're not. It's a very deep-rooted, difficult thing to purify completely. Even if you practice for many, many years the process, chant the holy name, is it possible to be very, very Krishna conscious, always thinking,
yeah, it is possible.
Because
it, but that is what, no, lust, anger, greed, envy, illusion, this is our disease. We are suffering from that disease. But still we are That's why we are taking to the medicine, the process of hearing the sound vibrations, so that we can eradicate them from our hearts. But they will be there, and this is not achieved that, we can, that is the process, we have to always think of Krishna, so that we can eradicate them. But ultimately, tesham evanu kampartham aham agyana jamtam nashami atma bhavasto jnana dipena bhashvata. Krishna comes and clears it for us when he feels this soul is making the right progress. You can, you shouldn't give up. You should try to do it, you know. We have to do our endeavor. Otherwise, Krishna's mercy will never come. But ultimately, it's not our achievement. It's Krishna's mercy. I think... it is one of the Chatur Shloki. I think Janita Prabhu, 10? 10, 11. Okay, because we are running out of time. But I can answer your question later.
I just have one quick question. You mentioned about humility, but I just want to know, how is it possible to keep a humble state of mind when it comes to your loved ones? Outside it's okay, I know it's manageable, but when you're within your loved ones, it's hard to keep the humility and humble state of mind.
Yeah, by respecting them for who they are and at whatever position of spiritual life they are. You know, when we learn to respect them always, under all circumstances, then we automatically become humble. Because sometimes what happens with relatives, we either take them for granted, become very familiar with them. Familiarity breeds contempt. That is also not good. Or we think, I am at a high level now, they are at a low level. But that is also not true, because, you know, if they get the mercy of Krishna, they can, through gurus, they can also become Krishna conscious. So if we learn to always respect them, no matter what the mind says, you know, they are like this, they are like that, but still respect them, then automatically we become humble. Humility is, you know, respecting everyone, every living entity, that they are part of Krishna. And I don't know everything, therefore I don't know who they are, and, you know, what they are doing. They may seem to be a non-devotee and yet be so close to Krishna. You know, I don't know, because I'm not all-knowing. Krishna is all-knowing. He knows. So let me leave it to him to make the judgments. I'll just respect them for who they are, and in my limited interactions with them, remain respectful like that. Thank you, Prabhu. That is what I can do with it. Thank you. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Ananta koti Vaishnava Vrinda ki jai.
Thank you very much, Ramcharan Prabhu. Nice class. I was going to ask one thing. Did you say that a conch shell is made from the bones of a cow? Okay. I'm pretty sure it's not. It's a shell of a sea snail or something like that. Pretty sure. I could be wrong, but just, yeah, because, yeah. Yeah. I did Google it while I was, yeah, it's from the sea. Shankha, was that Shankachuda? He's also the shell of the, yeah.
Yeah,
Shankhi's
shell.
Yeah.
Shankhi's shell.
Yeah. Just so that's clear, because I know sometimes people might think, oh wow, it's a bone of a cow.
Maybe
in these days they probably make them out of anything. They're probably also plastic ones and made from the teeth of someone, some village rodent. Okay. Anyway, just something. Okay. So, Last night we had a really nice program at Bhaktivedanta Manor, glorification of Jamuna Devi, Mother Jamuna. It's really, really wonderful. So just like to encourage devotees to take a little time, because after hearing so much about someone who is so important, and also specifically for us, I guess, because she was so valuable and instrumental in establishing the center here in London, then it's nice that we take some time out to really remember and glorify such an important personality. And last night, so many devotees were really saying so many wonderful and